The objective of this evening is for those of you in the audience that haven't researched, that haven't asked the questions about members, friends that fought in Vietnam, Korea, World War II, World War I, Civil War. This is an effort to try to motivate any of you and all of you to find out about your ancestors, what they did, and how they influenced you and your life and all of our lives. But I'm going to leave the introduction of Gregg to Steve.
Gregg is a journalist and historian and an author. And so one of the more interesting things I learned about him, when he was a young man in 1984, he went off to the Philippines on his own to be a freelance journalist. So he was there during the revolution when Marcos was overthrown. And out of that, and his contacts, he published a book in 1989 called Red Revolution Inside the Philippine Guerrilla Movement, which is an amazing accomplishment for a young man. And I'm sure that really jump-started his career. And he got some great reviews on it. His second book was Honor in the Dust, Theodore Roosevelt, War in the Philippines, and the Rise and Fall of America's Imperial Dream, which is a very complicated subject. He published that in 2012. I've read a lot about that, and it is a dicey subject. And his third book, which we discussed at the 6 o'clock session, was Last Stand at Quezon, published in 2014. A very interesting guy, very knowledgeable, as anybody from the 6 o'clock session can tell you. And this is what he's going to talk about tonight is something totally different, but of course it's related because it's about the fabric of our nation and every little aspect of it. And this is personal for Gregg, just as it's personal for our other speakers who will join us. So I'll welcome Gregg Jones.
It is so touching to me, powerful, particularly at this moment in our history when I think it's so important to know who we are, where we came from, to understand where we are and where we're going. That's a cause that defines my life to some extent is history. My love of history is what led me into journalism. I'm so grateful to see you all, and I thank you for being here tonight. The story that I want to tell you about, as I mentioned to some of the people earlier and the people I've met the last couple of days, that this is a story that really goes deeply into my childhood. And I want to flip to this image. This image is really what set me on a journey that continues to this day. And this was a bomber crew, as I would come to know. When I first saw this image, I was about 12 years old. My mother kept a very small, poor quality, smaller than 3x5, print of this on her dresser. It was a sacred item for her. Her oldest brother is the young man kneeling at the left in this photograph. His name was L.H. White, and he was the radio operator on this bomber crew. L.H., my mother's family, they grew up in poverty on a farm on the edge of the Cotton Belt in Arkansas, so about 70 miles from the Mississippi River. Lost the farm during the Depression, and L.H. became a migrant. He traveled the country working at racetracks. He was he was an exercise boy. He had a way with horses and with animals. And some of the family was migrating to Michigan to work in the auto factories. And so after some years, he somewhere along the line learned to tend bar. And so he was tending bar at a country club in Michigan at the time of Pearl Harbor and entered the Army Air Forces in February of 1942. This image, as I was growing up, it was a source of mystery. It was a source of sadness. My mother spoke very emotionally about the loss of her brother. And so I was drawn to it. I was already passionately interested in the Civil War and reading the Civil War. And then this really drew me into World War II and a family story of it. I didn't know much about it. My mother knew only fragments of the story. So there were really only a couple of other pieces of information. We would sometimes go, I grew up in southern Missouri, about 3 hours south of St. Louis on the edge of the Ozarks. And we would go to Jefferson Barracks National Cemetery. And there was a grave that we would visit. And there were 9 names on this gravestone. And one of them was L.H. White, my mother's oldest brother. But my mother always noted that there was some question whether the men were really there beneath this gravestone, whether they had ever been found. They disappeared over Austria in 1943. There was one other piece of information that that my mother knew, again with no details. There was a survivor. One member of the crew had survived. And as I would come to learn, it was the man in the back, second from the right, the navigator. I was 12. Little pieces of this mystery, of this family tragedy. When I was 15, I discovered this box in my mother's closet. It was the box of personal effects. So when a man went missing, they would box up his items and they would send it back to the States to the next of kin. This box had gone to my grandfather. My grandfather had passed away in 1967. He had left it to my mother. And I came across that box, and I will never forget that evening. I sat down in my room with that box in the floor. It was a winter's evening, and went through those items one by one. And there were things, there were extra uniform items. So there was a khaki tie, there was an extra flight suit, so boots and a flight jacket. There was a sheaf of documents, letters from the War Department to my grandfather about his son who had gone missing. There was a list of names of all the men on the crew and their hometowns and next of kin, so the families could write one another. And then there was a cigar box inside, that larger box, and it had the letters, the final correspondence between my grandfather and between L.H.'s final letters. And I read those letters, and L.H. Quit school after the eighth grade. He was needed on the farm. An education really wasn't needed. He knew how to plant cotton and how to grow cotton from a very early age. And so that's where he was needed. Another thing about these letters, my grandfather's final letters had been returned. They were unopened. They had been stamped, returned to sender, missing in action. And it's still very emotional for me, even remember holding those letters and looking at those heartbreaking words on it. And the letters had never reached their intended destination. They had never reached LH's hands. I very carefully opened those letters and read a father's final letters to a son, and letters he had written when he did not know that he had gone missing at that point. And then the first letter after he had received the MIA telegram, which was around the first week of November 1943. And my grandfather was a hard man. He was, in many ways, not a particularly kind man. But to see the fear in his handwriting and in his words and the loss and the effort to be hopeful. It was a very powerful thing. That evening for me, it set me on a journey of holding those items and wanting to know who these men were and what happened to them. Really became for me my mission, and as I would come to find out, it was the mission of the families left behind as well, was to find out the fate of these men and who they were. This was a photograph that also was in this box. This was LH on his final home leave in April of 1943, that he and his crew trained in early 1943. They went through training at Alamogordo Army Air Base in New Mexico and then Clovis. My mother's at the front left, that's her sister Hazel in the middle, and then my grandfather, Floyd. This is a scene from Jefferson Barracks. So this is where we would go, and again, the mystery for me was steeped by trying to understand what was this grave, and if the men weren't there, where were they? This document it's a document that's familiar with anyone that lost someone during the war, and this really set me on the larger journey in 1990. By then, I had been a journalist for a decade. I had always intended to try to track down this story, and I'd come home to visit my parents in Missouri, and I got that box out of my mother's closet again, and I knew it was time to really pursue this and once and for all to answer all these questions. This was what was sent to the families. Versions of this was typed, retyped, mimeographed, and sent to all of them. And the families were communicating with one another. And so this became for me in 1990 the starting point of, and as most of us in the room, but the students won't know, before the internet era, it was not a simple thing to track down someone in this country. You could try to find city directories and that sort of thing, but that entailed going to large libraries and a lot of research. So I started by writing letters to the hometowns of these men, and just simply writing a letter to the editor saying, I'm inquiring about this crew. If anyone remembers this man, if they remember the loss of this crew, please write to me. So I wrote newspapers across the U.S. I wrote newspapers in Austria as well. And almost immediately, I started to hear back from people. This was another letter that I was scouring all of these documents in this box for clues as to who might know something. And this letter was sent to all of the families, a variation of it, on December 20th, 1943. And it was written by Joseph Tate, who was squadron commander of the 328th, which was a part of the 93rd Bomb Group that they were flying with. 2 days after this letter was written, Joe Tate himself went missing over Europe. An extraordinary man, the hockey rink at West Point is named for Joe, and one of his brothers was also lost in the war. But I had a name. This was a name, even though Joe was missing, that this was another something that I hoped I could track down, either find relatives of Joe Tate or someone. And so I started trying to build these clues. I also learned about the Second Air Division Association, which was the umbrella group of the 93rd. The 93rd Bomb Group was the first B-24 group. They were sent to be sent to England. They arrived in October of 1942 and began flying missions. So I got the name of the Second Air Division Association, and I wrote the gentleman who was in charge of the 93rd organization, a radio operator by the name of Floyd Mabey. And I wanted to include this and some of these first letters because these meant so much to me to actually hear from a man who was flying with these crews. He was a member of the 93rd. He had survived his tour. And so this was a first link for me, really, to take me back to England in 1943 as I was trying to piece together the lives of these men in my mother's photograph. And so Floyd opened so many doors and began sending me information. I joined the group. This was all at the same time Floyd had sent me multiple letters. I had bombarded him with questions, and so he started trying to answer all these questions that I had sent him. Introduced me, gave me more names, and so I was soon writing men. Over a few years' time, I interviewed 150 men who had served in the 93rd Bomb Group. I initially had sent questionnaires. I was trying to find who was there in 1943 and try to find those men. And as I did that, slowly pieces of the story started to come together, and I started learning the names of friends, the men who were with them, men who were on the same missions. I started going to archives. I went to the National Archives in Washington, D.C. I went to the Air Force Archives at Maxwell Air Force Base and found sortie reports and started again building. I had more pieces of who they were flying with and men who might still be alive. This was the tail gunner on the crew, young man from Marion, Indiana, by the name of Philip Bedwell, and this is Phil's mother, Mub, Ava Bedwell. She went by Mub. Phil was the proverbial life of the party. He red hair, loved to bang away on the drums and dance, was always laughing and joking. I heard from Phil's sister, Barbara, very soon after I started sending out those letters in early 1990. And Barbara's mother, Mub, had been, as many of the family members, had been relentless in her search for information after getting word in 1943 that the crew had gone missing. And Mub would interview airmen when they came back. There were a few men in the 8th Air Force. There was a B-24 man in the 44th that was from their hometown. And Mub was writing people. She was tracking down people. And so she was, which was extraordinary for that time, but she was an investigator in her own right, trying to determine what had happened, what had become of her beloved Phil. And Barbara shared with me so many photographs. Barbara became my partner in this quest to find out what had happened to the crew. One of the things that Barbara told me about very quickly was the photograph of the crew showed them standing before an airplane by the name of War Baby. And so that's what I thought, that the aircraft that the crew was flying regularly. It turns out they were flying a very well-known aircraft, a very storied aircraft known as Jerks Natural. Barbara had photographs, had other information about that, and so she started providing so many pieces of this puzzle. You'll see Phil in the group photo. He is fourth from the left. And to familiarize you, by now I knew which of the men, who was who, and I knew their identities, and so I had more to go on. The pilot, William F. Stein, the upper left, Bill Stein was the son of Lithuanian immigrants in Naugatuck, Connecticut. His parents had worked in the rubber factories, and Bill had gone to Brown University on scholarship and majored in economics. Next to him was George B. Wilkinson from Amsterdam, New York, was a marvelous character, had been at West Point was scheduled to graduate with the class of 1937, had gotten in trouble along the way. That Phil was he was short of stature, and at Beast Barracks the summer of his plebe year, he had undergone merciless hazing, and so George had decided he was going to find every way possible to flout the rules of West Point, and he managed to do so, including building a liquor still in the woods outside the walls, and many other such antics. And I misspoke that Phil entered in 37, was scheduled to graduate with the class of 1941. Phil, 6 months short of graduation at West Point, had exceeded his limit of demerits, and it was something, as was wont to be, ticky-tacky. He had left his trash can not in the assigned space, and he got demerits for that, and they marched him down to the train station. Wilkie, as he was known, again, was this just marvelous spirit. As his distraught classmates watched him march off, he called out to them, "Don't worry, I'll be back." They did not accept him back. He was convinced America was going to war and they wouldn't dare drum out of West Point someone 6 months from graduation. He was wrong. Next to Wilkie is William Warren Sykes, was from Auden Reed, Pennsylvania, from the anthracite coal mining area of eastern Pennsylvania, was a navigator. John McDonough from Oakland, California, was the bombardier. Lower left, L.H. White, my uncle, was a radio operator. Next to him, William Statz, was a gunner. He was also trained as a radio operator, but with the Stein crew, he was operating as a gunner. Third from the left is Jack Kasparian, the son of Armenian immigrants who had gone through terrible struggles, wound up living in Los Angeles. Jack was the baby of the family. Phil Bedwell, and then the two men on the lower right, Mon R. Diltz and Kermit Morris, were from, Diltz was from Arizona, Morris was from New Mexico, and they were gunners on the crew. This was Jerk's Natural, this storied aircraft. If you've ever done much research or if you've built models, Jerk's Natural is more than likely the B-24 model that you would have built. It was named for a remarkable character from Racine, Wisconsin. John L. Gerstad was the original pilot. He was known as the Jerk because he was a soda jerk, worked in a soda shop. The Natural, the tail number 23711, the 711 was a Natural in dice and craps, and so hence Jerk's Natural. It had already been through more than 25 missions by the time the Stein crew arrived in England in late May of 43, and they were assigned to the 93rd in June of 43. And so the original crew had finished its allotted 25 missions, and the Stein crew took over this beautiful, battered, war-worn Jerk's Natural. This was John L. Gerstad, the original pilot. John L. Gerstad won the Medal of Honor, received the Medal of Honor for the Plo SD low-level mission. He was flying on another aircraft, but was one of the Medal of Honor recipients for the August 1st, 1943 mission, which the Stein crew was actually flying Jerk's Natural on that mission. And this was the original crew of Jerks Natural that the Stein crew took over from. As I was trying to investigate and get further into this, I was tracking down original members of the Stein crew, and this letter was written April 2nd, 1991. It was written by a wonderful gentleman, a Cajun gentleman from South Louisiana, Samuel Delcombe. Sam Delcombe was a member of the original crew, and he wrote me this lovely letter and recalled his missions and some of his memories. And that was another treasured moment as I started to understand the world in which these men had lived and the aircraft they had flown and the men who had come before them. At the bottom of that letter, he listed each of the missions he had completed. So it was a really a special letter for me. This original crew of Jerks Natural, because they had completed their mission without any of the members getting a scratch, they had an article that was being written about them for Air Force Magazine. And this article, just by chance, by a sad coincidence, ran in the October 1943 edition of Air Force Magazine. The Stein crew was flying Jerks Natural on October 1st, 1943, when they did not return from Austria. This was a scene of just, you can see the camaraderie and the brotherhood of members of the Stein crew during training. On the far right, that was my uncle, L.H., with the bill of his cap turned up, as some of the men were wont to do. And then that was Jack Kasparian, just to the left, and Phil Bedwell. The man on the far left was with the crew in training and went AWOL one too many times and didn't finish with them. So this is a Jerks Natural in flight. This was an extraordinary photograph that one of the men I interviewed in the 93rd sent me, and it's a beautiful photograph. And the B-24 had its detractors, but this for me is a very stirring image. As I was piecing together the story of these men, I was going through sortie reports like this. I learned that the men had gone into combat on July 5th. They had flown down to North Africa. The B-24 crews were the utility players, if you will, of the 8th Air Force. That at that point, the original B-24 group was the 93rd Bomb Group, the 44th. Came over, and then the 389th. And because of their long range and their load capacity, that they were sent off for these various temporary duty assignments. And so the 93rd had already done one assignment around the time of the North Africa invasion of the fall of 42, and had come back to England. And so then the Stein crew and other crews of the 93rd were sent down to North Africa at the end of June to fly missions in support of the Sicily landing and also to fly the low-level Ploesti mission. So these were the early missions. Jerks Natural was worn. The engines were wearing down. The desert conditions, they were based at Benghazi, Libya, in the desert there. And so they had a number of turnbacks. Engines failed frequently. The sand scoured the engines, and the turnbacks were quite common at that time. On August 1st, 1943, the crew had flown the Great Ploesti low-level mission, and the horror of it, if you've seen the images or read about it, it's really hard to imagine. And what these men were seeing, and the planes were very close together. There was chaos over the target. There had been a wrong turn, and so the men were coming in from an unfamiliar direction. But they were flying just above the smokestack level. Planes were exploding, And so imagine you're seeing your friends in the next plane, men on fire, jumping out at low level, jumping out of the aircraft, just trying to escape the aircraft, even though they had no chance of parachuting at that low level of the parachutes opening, watching bombers crash into refinery buildings and other things. And it was a very traumatic moment for the crew. Jerks Natural was shot up and losing fuel. They couldn't make it back to Benghazi. So they landed, made an emergency landing on Sicily at a recently liberated airfield that had British Spitfires, RAF Spitfires. The plane was repaired overnight, and they flew back to North Africa the next day. Tensions were starting to happen within the Stein crew. In the earlier session, we talked about combat stress and what we now know as PTSD. And the crew was really undergoing strain. One gunner left the crew. He had argued with pilot Bill Stein after the PLOSD mission. The gunner was concerned by the turnbacks, the aborted missions, and actually went so far as to accuse Stein of cowardice, which I don't think at all was the case. I've interviewed a number of pilots that flew with Bill Stein, but a 19-year-old hot-headed gunner had his opinions, and so he left the crew. The two men on the lower right left the crew shortly after this photograph was taken. So the crews returned to England in late August of 1943. These men took themselves off flying status. The one on the far right, Kermit Morris, had collapsed in the bottom of the plane on the PLOSD mission, curled up in the fetal position, was just so badly traumatized. So both of those men took themselves off flying status, and so the Stein crew started flying every mission then through September. They were flying with replacement gunners. If somebody wasn't flying that day and they were looking to get extra missions. And so on their final mission, they had been sent back down then to North Africa in mid-September. And so they were flying out of Tunis at that point, striking targets in Italy, striking targets. This last mission was to Wiener Neustadt, Austria, to a German Messerschmitt factory, and they did not return. This was the missing air crew report that was prepared, and when the crew didn't return, typically this missing air crew report would be prepared. In this case, the Stein crew fell through the cracks, and a missing air crew report was not prepared for 5 months, and when it was prepared, there was wrong information that was put on it, and so the mystery, the uncertainty deepened then of what actually happened to these men. The report in this, in the missing air crew report, stated that they had turned back before the target and were last seen over the coast of Yugoslavia. That gave hope to the families when they got that word. Maybe the men are with Tito's partisans in the mountains of Yugoslavia. And so they continued to cling through that hope. A week after the MIA telegrams went out, the family of the navigator, William Warren Sykes, got a telegram saying, "Your son is confirmed POW. He's being held by the Germans." Sykes was held at Stalag Luft 3, the scene of the Great Escape, in March of 1944. He survived the war. He survived the very horrific march in January of 1945 as the Soviets were coming in from the east. The Germans were moving prisoner of war camps and sending them westward. And so they marched from Poland into southern Germany. And he was there when he was liberated in May of 1945, and he returned to the States. All this time, the families had been in agony, had been uncertain what was the status of the men. And so when Sykes came home, families were calling and going to eastern Pennsylvania to talk to him. He was polite. His family was very, it's a very nice family. He answered their questions, but was very terse. His account was they had lost one engine just before the target, probably to flak. Right after the target, they were jumped by three ME-109 fighters, and the plane had slipped into a spin, but they lost both engines on the starboard side. And so being in the nose, as the navigator was, he saw that, and he popped through the nose wheel hatch and parachuted to safety. The other men didn't leave the plane. His account, he believed that the plane didn't pull out of a spin. He also said that later that day, the Austrian showed him watches and rings that he recognized as those belonging to his comrades. This is where the story was really frozen in time for nearly 50 years. This was the account in late 1945 that William Sykes wrote the official account for the Air Force. In the late 1947, the Army, the War Department started repatriating all of the remains from overseas. And so this was the scene from that repatriation. The families were notified in 1949. The remains had been found, but they were not given information as to how identification had been made or why there was any certainty that they had actually found the men. The families then received a telegram, come to Jefferson Barracks in March 13th, 10:07 a.m. for a funeral. The families appeared at Jefferson Barracks. There was one coffin. They were stunned by this. There had been no warning, and there was no explanation. Most of the families left the cemetery that day convinced that the men had never been found. This was the scene from the funeral on March 13th, 1950 at Jefferson Barracks. Reese says Crew 28, that was their designation in training. That on the left, the gentleman on the left, that's William Warren Sykes, the navigator, came to the funeral. I tracked him down a year or so before he died in the 90s. It's a wonderful family. Gotten to know his wife, his sons. He came to the funeral, but he was always he was very stoic about it. And as they were driving away, his wife told me, she asked him, "This must have been very hard for you." And he said, "No, this is in the past." And he took a very very hard position with that, and it was jarring for me, his words, and it was interesting. At the same time, we hear about survivor's guilt, and one can only wonder how one handles such an event. His wife didn't even know when she married him in the late 40s that he had been a POW. He was waking up with nightmares, screaming, "The SOBs are on our tail," and that was the first that she knew of it. But he came to the funeral, which was certainly a gesture of brotherhood with his crewmates, and the families continued to write one another and stay in touch. But the questions still remained. And when I started this search in the early 90s, I was casting as wide a net as I could and writing newspapers in Austria as well, I found the name of a village in a document I got through a Freedom of Information request. And one day in the fall of 1991, a brown envelope arrived in the mail, and I could tell immediately this was from from overseas. And I sat down, I just had a sense of what it was. And it was like that moment when I was opening the letters of my grandfather and LH. And I opened it up, and there was this photograph. And this boy was the son of a police chief near the village where the survivor had parachuted down. And there was a crash site there. There was an aircraft that crashed. And the question was this Jerks natural? They believed it was. And so that became imperative for me than to go to this village and start interviewing people and to find out, was this the aircraft? I went for the first time in late 1991, and the innkeeper, the survivor, William Sykes, had been taken to the local inn in this beautiful village on the edge of the Alps in southern Austria, about 30 miles north of Graz. And he had, the innkeeper had been one of the first people at the crash site. He had passed away, but his son was running the inn, and his son had actually been to the crash site that day, was a boy of about 10 at the time. And so the innkeeper took me out to this place that we believed to be the crash site. And we knelt in the snow, and he was trying to, my German was not very good then, and it's not particularly good now, but he was trying to mime for me, and through the little bit of language that we shared, explain to me what happened and drawing in the snow. And he also said to me, if you can come back, I will get everyone in this area that knows anything about this to talk to you. I came back 2 months later. The inn was filled with 50 or 60 people. People had documents. People had pieces of the plane. One person presented me with a piece. It was the oxygen regulator, so the switch where you could control the flow of oxygen to your mask. People had carburetors. The innkeeper himself had the hoist that was used to hoist bombs up into the bomb bay, used it in his barn. That's where he hung the hogs that were being slaughtered. And they used pieces of it. A boy, not this boy, but a young boy who was nearly struck by the plane when it came in, I found him. His family say he saved a life raft and also part of the tail, which they used as a stovetop. These were hard times. Rubber and metal were very scarce and becoming more scarce in 1943. In time, it became clear to me, this is Jerk's Natural, beyond any doubt. And I learned the story, and for me, it was such a powerful and sad thing at the same time. But one of the things that I learned from people on the ground was the pilots had regained control, the pilot and co-pilot. The plane had been in a spin, and the implication of William Sykes's testimony was the plane had never pulled out of the spin. It simply plowed into the ground. They were trying to land, and they had nearly landed. There was a police report. They had nearly landed on a meadow about a mile or two away. And for some reason, they pulled up at the last minute, and they circled back. This meadow is at the base of a mountain called Pommersberg. And on that particular day, it was overcast, and there was a shaft of sunlight on this meadow. And so they tried to land there, but it was a very steep downhill sloping meadow, and so the plane clipped a tree coming in, lost part of the tail, and hit hard. They had half a load of fuel, and the plane exploded. The villagers treated the men with reverence. They buried them in the parish cemetery in two oversized coffins. That became, for me, my trips back to the village, and I was drawn back again and again. The reverence and the commonality of the experience, and the fact that that village lost so heavily themselves. They lost about 75 young men from a village of about 700 people. So they were hoping that their sons were being treated with reverence as they were falling on distant battlefields as well. It became really one of the beautiful things. Coming to know the families like this, knowing the siblings, the sisters. This is John McDonough, the bombardier, a beautiful soul. He was a writer, an aspiring writer. Had been at Cal Berkeley when he went into the armed forces. had washed out of pilot school, and he really had loved All Quiet on the Western Front, which is the great anti-war World War I novel, and it was there was such a sad irony to it that he became the man dropping the bombs, and yet he had, I think, this gentle soul, and he was the one. And his sisters, I was able to share information with them. There was, I'll quickly tell you, a really tragic story that in the middle is his sister Pat. So his sister Adela is still living, sister Pat, and then mother Patricia, who passed away. But the sister Pat told me she had been married to a guy around the end of the war, and wasn't a very nice guy. And this guy was a bit of a blowhard, and he came back and he told her he'd investigated John's disappearance and that he had discovered John had lived and had been incarcerated in a concentration camp. And so Pat had lived for decades with the horror of every time she would see an image of the concentration camps, of thinking that John, who was this strapping, handsome guy, was a Jack LaLanne fitness follower back in the day, that he had died this horrible existence wasting away in a concentration camp. And for me, one of so many gratifying moments was being able to share with Pat and with other families that this isn't what happened, that the men had met their fate in that meadow and they had not suffered. The families remained in touch for many years, and when I started reaching out to them, the families, we reconnected. They were sharing photographs. This was Mrs. McDonough had written, exchanged photos with Mrs. Bedwell and writing notes on them, and it was such a beautiful, in their shared sorrow and pain, just the way that they had bonded like their sons had bonded. These were images that also just brought home to me what boys they were, what clowning around, and it was a window into their personality and their lives. I'll close with this: that in 1996, we were certain by then. I was certain beyond any doubt that we had the right place and the right crew and the right crash. We put up a monument in this beautiful meadow that has been reclaimed by forest, and it had become the mission of the last mission of the families to find out what happened, and to those of us a generation or more removed, our last mission became keeping alive the memory, bearing witness to who these men were, that they had lived, that they had lives unfulfilled, and putting a memorial up at this place, this beautiful place, was one of the ways of honoring these men and trying to keep alive their memory. This is the stone. It's a natural stone, and we had a plaque made. It is a sacred place. Thank you very much. Yeah.
Barbara's family story is a little different, but she's gone through many of the same search mechanisms that Gregg described. But Barbara has had a relative in the 8th Air Force, and let's talk about his story.
This is my Uncle Bud's story. In the spring of 1943, he'd flown only three missions before being shot down over France on May 17th. He was able to parachute and land and evaded capture for 6 months in occupied France. Bud Wilschke was married to my dad's sister, Rosemary. Bud passed away in 2001. But by all accounts, like many World War II veterans, he rarely spoke of his wartime experiences. In fact, the only time I remember ever hearing of this story was once over 30 years ago in 1983. At the time, I was busy with my job and my own family, and I'm sorry to say I gradually forgot all about the story. Then, in May of 2015, 2 years ago, my neighborhood book club was discussing this book called The Nightingale by Kristen Hanna. It's a novel set in World War II France with the themes of French resistance and Allied airmen's escape and evasion at its center. One of the other book club members scoffed at the part when the airmen were led on a daring nighttime trek over the Pyrenees Mountains to reach neutral Spain. She thought that was ridiculous and just too unbelievable, and the author had made up the whole thing. And that's when I told her, no, this really happened, and this happened to my uncle. So, okay, now I was really curious to find out more about my uncle's story. So I called my cousin Jim, Bud and Rosemary's eldest son. Jim started sending me photographs and artifacts over the internet and eventually invited me to his house in suburban Chicago, where he loaned me this incredible collection of photos, letters, and documents, the big box, that had been in deep storage at his house. Now, I've been working ever since to piece together all these little facts to put Bud's remarkable story together and make sure it's not lost to time. The radio operator on the aircraft that day, Bob Neal, was the only other crewman to parachute safely and evade capture. The two men were brought together by their French helpers, and for the next 6 months, they were hidden and helped by over 25 different French families as they tried to make their way back to England. This is the approximate route that they took. Over the target, the U-boat base at Lorient, they were hit by enemy fighters, and Bud managed to drop the payload before they were hit again, which started the aircraft on fire and forced everyone to bail out. So here's their little route. They finally ended up making their way to the Eastern Pyrenees, where they hiked for 2 nights, finally crossing into Spain on foot on November 17th, exactly 6 months to the day that they were shot down. This past fall, as a part of my research, I've been contacting people in France, people at the different towns and cities where I know he was hiding. And I've made contacts, and there are many people over there very familiar with his story on that side. They know where he was sheltered, and they know some of the people who were helping him. They told me that a memorial ceremony is planned at the crash site for May 8th, France's World War II Victory Day, and we've all been invited to attend. 7 Wilschkes are planning to go, as well as my husband, and my daughter, and my sister, and I. Me. So that's coming up in just a few weeks. So I'll finish with the fact that although I've always been fascinated by World War II history, I'm really a Bud Wilschke expert, not a World War II expert. So for me, this project has just been a wonderful and fascinating gift. Thank you.
Ruth was one of the triggers that initiated the idea for the program this evening. And as I said earlier, her request to help came about the same time I had seen Gregg's story on C-SPAN. So let's hear the story of your family story. Yes. Thank you.
I'm glad to be here. If history were taught in the form of stories, it would never be forgotten, Rudyard Kipling. History is happening all around us every day, and stories can help remind us that we are as much a part of it as those whose names dominate the headlines. Linda Sue Park. I'm thankful for the gift that has been offered to me through Gregg Jones expressing his uncle's story, giving additional place for my story to reside. All that I hear, I latch on to my reference point with my maternal uncle's military experience, Second Lieutenant Richard Rossman. This is him at 4 years old, full of spirit, full of life. I may not know the expanse of the all that was happening throughout the war, but I do know the particulars of one soldier's story and the part he played and how his sacrifice continues to spread its impact. It exists somewhere extremely deep, this legacy. the responsibility of honoring this single story, the part that connects me to all who have come before me. Snapshot, 1965. It could have been Memorial Day or the 4th of July, and we'd bring down my uncle's World War II military flag from the attic, with a reverence of care, unfurling it so it didn't touch the floor, draping it out my bedroom window, making certain that the stars pointed to the north. It suspended down to the first floor of our home, shrouding the expanse of our dining room window. It would move with the wind as our mashed potatoes would be passed at the table or as the roast was being carved. It was as if he, my uncle, was present in a way that could be felt, not fully understanding its significance, but knowing there was a hushed importance. This is when I believe the rumblings of the story began. Fast forward decades later, snapshot, 2014. I find myself scanning through my uncle's military artifacts that my mom had sequestered in a box, along with items I found after clearing out my parents' home. My mom had passed and my dad now was living in a healthcare facility. And the story began speaking loudly to me, or impatiently. And I was feeling more the responsibility of being the safekeeper of these mementos, knowing that they needed to step outside of their box. So after going through the box, this is what I learned. And here he is. Second Lieutenant Richard Rossman was a pilot of a B-24 Liberator that flew out from Brindisi, Italy on December 19th, 1943. That its primary target that day was the Messerschmitt factory in Augsburg, Germany, and that it headed for the Alps, the secondary target, Innsbruck, Austria, where the plane was attacked and crashed. He was part of the 15th Air Corps, the 98th Bomber Group, the 343rd Bomber Squadron. There had been 11 on the plane instead of the typical 10. An extra soldier was catching a ride to their new base after flying this mission. There were two POWs that survived the crash. There was a year of waiting and hopefulness as the remaining 9 soldiers were listed missing in action, and that letters were sent stateside amongst the different family members. That the time of waiting and not knowing abruptly ended with a letter received on January 13th, 1945, stating that my uncle, as well as the remaining 8 crew members, were now listed, killed in action. My uncle's remains were brought to Jefferson Barracks National Cemetery in 1950. This box contained his passport and a photo of him along with his crew. There was his Purple Heart and letters the family members had sent back and forth to each other for over a year, where hope was choosing to reside. There were letters from grandmas and wives and sisters and fathers and brothers, all splashing across the continent from Pennsylvania to Arkansas to Texas to Minnesota to Oklahoma to New York to Illinois to Indiana to Michigan to Mississippi. For the soldiers were from all corners of the United States. All the families were trying to fill in the blanks with what they didn't yet know. Optimism being at the front of what they spoke about. There was also his training flight logbook and a photo postcard from Texas of him and 2 other soldiers addressed specifically to my mom. So, I took some of the key items I thought would most effectively tell his story in a book format, the story I wanted to share, taking many of the items and reprinting them and shrinking them down to fit onto a 4x6-inch page. Some of the letters were put into tiny envelopes. The replicated miniature passport could be opened. I wanted the reader to be intimate with this story, showing how personal and real it all was. Since creating and then sharing my uncle's story, I've learned that when a story has a beginning and an end, it gives other people a place to offer their own story. I've learned that when creating a story, you don't have to have all the specifics, that you can tell it from what you know and how the story has felt to you. I've learned that when a story wants to be told, it won't go away. And it can become persistent or even annoying. I've learned that when you think your story is complete, it may have more to tell you. I've learned that elements of the story can change as more information is acquired. I've learned about the importance of being open to the questions the story brings forward and allowing space for that which may not yet have a place to fit. I've learned that new information may be unwrapped and you may not always be ready for it. Give space and time for the process to unfold. I've learned that stories typically have a lot of backstory, and that's part of their charm. I've learned that it's important to keep the story succinct and heartfelt. I've learned to honor all the stories that are an outgrowth of the original story. Specifics about Richard's story that I learned. I learned that my mom had taught me how to honor someone she loved by speaking his name and telling his stories. I learned that love can connect you with someone in a way that reaches beyond earthly boundaries. I learned that stories are expansive. Little did I know that there was a World War II British soldier who had married an Austrian and moved to Volders, Austria shortly after the war, the mountainside town nearest to my uncle's crash site. This Brit did research about the plane that had crashed and had many conversations with eyewitnesses who were there when it went down. Little did I know an Italian teacher decades later would take an interest in doing research on airstrikes over Germany on a particular day, and that he would choose Sunday, December 19th, 1943, the day my uncle's plane crashed. Little did I know I could Google map the crash site and see remnants of the plane and a plaque designating what had transpired in such a place so many years before. Little did I know a town historian of Volders would frequently take high school groups to the site. Little did I know I would be in contact with one of the offspring of one of the surviving soldiers from the plane crash. Little did I know her sibling had ventured to Austria some years ago and had climbed the mountainside to the site, bringing back some small parts of the plane, and that she would pass one of those parts to me just before Veterans Day, 2015, taking the story to a whole new level. Little did I know I would create an iMovie from the book and that I would put it on YouTube on the 72nd anniversary of the crash in hopes that I might make contact with other people who have some connection with the story, enabling more to be added. Little did I know that someone in Innsbruck, Austria would access the YouTube video and let me know he had just climbed to the crash site this past August. Bridging the distance of this story from past to present and into the yet to be revealed, making it only a simple breath away, truly connecting me with the more of this story that I never could have imagined uncovering before I created Richard's story. We are not created in isolation, and what we each do is truly significant. Speaking to the importance of history, knowing what has transpired, allows us to bookmark more of what is presently happening with a foundation, a relativeness of what others have done and learned. We are our history, and we are all a part of each other's ongoing history that is being cultivated within every moment. There is importance in speaking the story we know. Never certain what might be brought forward, but the stories are never lost, as I have seen by the many hands and hearts that are now linked to my uncle's single story. It just shows how everything we do has a gravity that we may never see nor fully know, but that doesn't mean it is any less important. Being present, offering what we know, gifting a piece of ourselves to the world. Our stories are not flying solo. We are truly a collective, forever linked. Help the world by leaving a trail of who you are, Mark Nepo. If stories come to you, care for them and learn to give them away where they are needed. Barry Lopez.
Bert Carrolls. Where are you, Bert?
Right here.
Right here. It's apropos that Bert served in the 93rd Bombardment Group. And what was your squadron, Bert?
The 328th
your
squadron.
328th?
93rd, yeah.
And what was your position?
I was a nose turret gunner on the Liberator bomber, yes.
Bert said he was a nose turret gunner. Did you say navigator also?
No, we had a separate navigator.
Okay, so you were up in the nose of a B-24D model?
Right, 35 missions over here.
35 missions. Thanks for coming, Bert. When did you muster out?
I think it was in 1945, in May, I think.
He thinks he mustered out in May of 1945.
Yeah. Okay.
And then did you stay with the same airplane throughout your entire?
No, it was a different one every time we flew. It depended on how badly they were shot up, you know, from the last trip. So they had to patch them up a little bit and send them back out again, you know. But anyway, I think it was the second mission, I kind of wanted to go to the pilot and say, I don't think I want to do any more of these things. But he didn't want to agree with that. But it ended up that there was a shell came through the turret, and it took the whole side of the pants off here and went out alongside of my head here. The shell was going out there. So they got that close to me, but they didn't get me anyway. So that... I'm here tonight anyway. Yeah.
Well, glad you could come, Bert.
And I'm 92 years old.
92.
Your son.
And I was
son,
pleased.
His son brought him. He's from Henderson, Minnesota, right?
Henderson, Minnesota. That's down on the...
I think this 8th Air Force guy needs to recruit a Wednesday. And Al, here's another story for the Legion newspaper.
We have another birthday guy in the audience here. I brought this young fellow right here, Jerry Nouse. 94 years old yesterday. He served in the Big Red One, 1st Division, very famous infantry division. So glad you could make it, and good to see you, Jerry. My Uncle Floyd, who had a sister Hazel, was a 93rd Bomb Group 328 Squadron. I guess we're all here 328th tonight. And I'll mention when I get done with his story, I'll talk a little bit about the 93rd and what's going on with it today, which still exists. But while the thought crosses my mind, because I was born 3 days before the Battle of Midway, so it's starting to slip a little bit. There was an image that Gregg showed up there of an airplane that was tipped on the side going through Ploesti. Most of you don't know that actually is the negative image. And the reason I know this is because we did a Ploesti summit in Tucson, Arizona in 2011. I was very fortunate to be able to make contact with the pilot of that plane called Robert Sternfels. He was living in California. And the first thing he wanted to get across to me and make sure I understood was that image, which is the most popular image, is wrong. That actually the plane is tipped the other way because what everybody has seen is the negative, not the positive side. So a little bit of trivia there. My connection with World War II, I guess you might say, has got four parts to it besides being born during the war and always growing up being known as a war baby. My father was drafted at age 28 in 1944. The infantry was getting pretty close to the bottom. They were scarce for foot soldiers, and he got drafted in less than 6 months. January 45, he was on the front, and unfortunately, he lost his life in March of 45. My Uncle Floyd, he was enlisted, I think, in 1943. Late 1943, or January 44, they were over. They had made England, and they were flying missions, and they did a mission on the way to Calais, France, to knock out the rocket launchers when his plane was shot down over Bruges. If you're French, you call it Bruges. If you're Flemish and live in North Belgium, you call it Brugge. But it's about 20 miles from the English Channel, and it was the IP for this particular mission, and that's where he lost his life. The fourth part was my stepfather, who happened to be a good friend of my natural father. He married my mother in 1946, and he had joined the National Guard in his little town of Windham, Minnesota, back in 1940. And his unit, they were anti-aircraft artillery. His unit was activated and sent to San Bernardino, California, in June of 1941. In September, they were on their way to Kodiak, Alaska, because that's, of course, where our government thought that the Japanese were going to invade. He spent 3 years on Kodiak, Alaska, in anti-aircraft artillery. The most thing that happened was, they had one incident where he was on guard duty one night, and he was with another guy, and they were walking along in the shadows, and they saw this fellow back in the shadows with a hump on his back, and the other fellow said to halt. He didn't halt. The figure kept moving. Halt again. He kept moving. So not my stepfather, but the other guy took a shot at him and blew him all to pieces. He had been heading for the radio tower. So there obviously was an attempt at sabotage there on little Kodiak Island. Otherwise, there wasn't too much going on there for about 3 years. So finally, our government figured out that nothing was going on there, and they took those guys and they sent them to Texas in late 44, retrained them, and they ended up the war, of course, over in Germany. My stepfather's last job was to take German prisoners of war back to their hometowns down around the Munich area and collect weapons, which is a whole different story. But I want to talk about my Uncle Floyd from the 93rd Bombardment Group and his story, how I kind of found out what happened to him, which none of my family knew. He had three sisters, four. Florence, Mildred, Hazel, and my mother Alice, who was the youngest. And Floyd was the youngest. He was the baby. He was the only boy. He enlisted in Chicago. Don't know why he came from Jeffers, Minnesota, which is down in the southwest corner of the state in Cottonwood County. A farm boy, but somehow he ended up in Chicago, and that's where he enlisted. He was, the crew that he went over to England with kind of was all together from the beginning, and except for the co-pilot. The co-pilot, after about 2 months before they did go to England, the co-pilot joined them in Salt Lake City, and they all went to England. So fast forward to June 19th, 1944. The mission is, as they said, is Calais, France. The IP, initial point, was just over Bruges, Belgium. The night before, and Bruges, by the way, is a medieval town. For those of you who have been there, it's just a gorgeous little town. It's circular, kind of oval-shaped. It had six gates where they used to take the cattle out and you know, to the fields, and then they'd bring them back at night. There was a complete moat around it. The city hasn't ever been hit by any of the wars, so it's pretty much intact. But anyway, that was the IP. And the night before the mission, which would be the 18th of June of 44, the Germans brought an 88 up from northern France and positioned it at Bruges. I never was able to do the research to find out why that would have occurred, but they were there. The crew, and by the way, just a small detail, my uncle did not fly in the pilot's position that day. He flied co-pilot. He had just come out of the hospital and was supposed to go home, but he insisted to fly because his crew was on number 28 that day out of 30, and he wanted to be with them. So he could fly, but he's going to have to fly co-pilot. And his co-pilot, who was Robert Brown, passed away just a year ago this month at age 99. He was pilot on that mission. They get to Bruges, they get hit with an 88 just outside of number 4 engine. The shell didn't explode, but it weakened the wing to such a point that the engine, I guess, stopped. The plane went into a flat spin. They were able to bring it out by throwing it into autopilot. I don't know about the mechanics of that, but Bob told me that that's what happened. And long enough, he stabilized the plane. When I say he, my uncle was too weak to operate the plane. Now, my uncle was not a very large man. Fortunately, Mr. Brown, who was a pretty good-sized guy, was able to manage the aircraft. My uncle had tried but had to give it back to him because he was just too weak, having been in the hospital. When they got hit and they went into the flat spin and brought it out, Pilot Brown tried to go on the intercom and tell the crew to bail. Apparently the intercom had failed, so we hit the bells and the crew started bailing out. Everybody got out. Brown was the last one to get, well, Brown was not the last one. He was number 7 to get out. All the rest had gotten out. The airplane was, the wing was just starting to break on the right side because of the shell. So he was number 7. He said he had to chin himself out through the bomb bay to be able to get out because the plane had gone upside down. My uncle was still trying to fly the plane. Now that's the part of that mission that I would sure like to know what's going through my uncle's head. You know, why did he ask his navigator to give him he wanted to take the plane back to England. That's what the order was to the navigator. And the nose gunner, by the way, is also up in front. And the nose, three of them didn't get out, or two didn't get out. Wait a minute, what are you saying? My uncle got out, the radio man got out, but the nose gunner did not get out. The centrifugal force just kept him in there. Now, here's why I know this. I started asking questions probably about 1990 of my mother. What happened to your brother? Because he was not brought back here. They thought there was no remains. And she said, well, we don't know. The only thing that I knew about it was he was somehow connected with the 93rd Bombardment Group. And I think I found that out from a guy named Ed Keppers, who years and years ago was a historian for the 8th Historical Society when they used to meet at Holman Field. Does anybody remember Ed Keppers? He had a complete file on so much stuff, and he was able to retrieve a picture. He was able to retrieve the crew list. And that kind of started me on the mission. So I started writing letters, too, to all these people. The one fellow came from Palmer, Alaska, and I don't know how many letters I wrote up there. A letter to the editor in the newspaper, no response. And I found out years later that, except for the pilot Brown, the other 6 guys had died early in their life. I have no idea why. They did become POWs, of course, at the crash site. Brown went to Stalag Luft 3. And he was in the same march in 1945 back from up by Berlin. I think the POW camp was in Poland. So that march, they took him out of Poland and they marched him down to around Munich. But my story was I joined the 93rd Bomb Group reunion group, which was then just kind of firing up. They had been meeting with the 2nd Air Division but decided they had enough people coming to the reunions, they do their own separate reunions, which they started to do about sometime in the early 90s. So I joined the group, I wrote to the editor, and I gave him my list of questions, and he came back and says, about 6 months ago, this fellow from Belgium sent me about the same list of questions. So I got back to the editor, whose name was Paul Steschen. This is Paul. How do you contact this guy? He gave me a phone number. I'm on the telephone immediately, and I get a hold of Jacques Willems in Bruges, Belgium. Make a long story short, he has a 16-year-old, saw the airplane get shot, crash, and ironically, when he was reaching the end of his working career, he joined the local aviation historical group, and his city, on the 50th anniversary of the crash, which would have been 2000, or 94? 1994. The city wanted to do a celebration to that crew because that crash was the event of World War II for that city. And it was really important to them to try to commemorate that event, which really humbled me that they would do this. But not uncommon for that part of Europe, as I understand. But one of the stipulations was, and they hired Jacques to put this whole thing together, one of the stipulations was he had to find a crew member, or at least some kind of relative of the crew member. Well, Jacques ran into the same problem I did, just a complete zero on any of the crew, just couldn't locate anybody. In the meantime, he had the German debriefing of the seven POWs. He had the American debriefing from after the war when the guys went home. But what he was missing was the gap of when they got hit by the 88 shell and that whole business. Someplace about 1997 or 98, there was one crew member left, and he happened to be a good friend of my uncle's. I got a hold of him. He was in Tucson, Arizona, Oliver Wood. And he and I had about a 10-minute conversation. And one of the things he said to me was, you know, the night before that mission, your uncle got a Dear John letter from his wife of 6 months when they had, or a year ago when they had been in Bakersfield, California. He ran into a gal out there who was a base chaser, and they got married. And so the night before the mission, he gets this Dear John letter. Had no idea, of course, where to go with that. But so one thing led to another. I get an email from the daughter of Oliver Wood. He's passed away now. But I get an email about 1998 from her that she got wind that the pilot, Brown, is still living. He lives in some place in the United States. She doesn't know where. So I looked up on the various internet sources for Robert S. Brown. I got five of them. I started with a guy in Chicago and finally got to Springfield, Missouri, where there was two Robert Browns. So I wrote this letter. I sent it to the first one. It says, if you're not him, would you please send it to the second one? Well, it was the first one. That was 1999. And Robert Brown, who after the war had come back and had a career in the Missouri Highway Patrol, was living down there. He had retired, but he was very reluctant to talk to me or to even see me. But I prevailed. He did agree to see me, so I picked up my mother, who was living in Minnesota still, and we went down to Springfield. And the first day was kind of icy. And I'll explain why in a minute, at least I think so. The second day he agreed to talk to me and to answer some questions that I had. By the third day, we sat down. He said I could put my tape player down on the table. And I started with softballs, you know, about things not about war. I think sometimes when we're trying to find out about an uncle, a father's, but the history of, you know, Dad, what did you do in the war? It doesn't always open the door. So I kind of use what I called softballs to try to build some trust between him and myself. And after a couple of days of the informalities, he was ready to sit down and talk turkey, as they say. He talked for 2.5 hours. And the gap between what Jock had leading up to the crash and after the crash finally started filling in. And Bob, he could recall this just to the microsecond. He said, you know, this thing hit, and I did this, and this happened, that happened. And he gave everybody orders to bail out. My uncle refused to bail out. My uncle disobeyed orders is basically what it amounts to. And whatever was going through his mind, as I mentioned, the Dear John letter from the night before, I've always felt in talking to other pilots and airmen that the first thing you think about is the crew and the airplane doing your mission. So that's the way I think about it. And if there was some influence there that he had, it's not important. But that's just one of those little wrinkles that drops into the equation about how a person thinks under that kind of stress. We did find out what happened to my uncle. He was somehow blown out of the plane, he and the radio man. They both landed with unopened chutes. And in the case of my uncle, he landed in the room next to where a father and his son were sitting having their dinner. And my uncle landed in the next room. So we were able to get pretty good information. So now that Jock's got a real live person that who is a relative, because all the crew except for Brown, and at that point Brown was not able to get around so much, he was in a wheelchair. But I went, my wife and I were invited in July, 4th of July weekend 2004, to just a grand ceremony. It was about 200 people there. They had the color guard from the air base in Stuttgart, Germany. The ambassador was there, various speakers and so forth. And today on a wall about 100 yards from where the plane crashed is a beautiful plaque with my uncle's name, his two crew members. And it was just a marvelous ceremony. I've never been so humbled about an event as I was there. And we went to a reception in a house that was made for 100, but there was 200 in there. And these people kept coming up to me. This one woman came up and she couldn't speak English, but she had this book. The book was kind of olive drab. And she says to me, or I finally understood that the cover of the book came from the canvas, from the flaps or the ailerons or whatever was made out of canvas. That's where that came from. I did try to recover metal, but was told basically that the Germans had come in and confiscated all the metal that was left on the plane, because they needed it, of course, for their own war effort. I suppose, in summation, you have to be persistent in these quests, as these two ladies can address, and Gregg also. And dots can be connected, but you just can't give up, and you have to kind of go outside the box. And in my case, you know, things drop into place. It took about 10 years for me to get to Brown, but once I was able to get to Brown, and by the way, since I found him in 99, we've become really good friends. One of the last things he did for me, in the 93rd, by the way, we're an active reunion group. There's a newsletter we put out four times a year. There's a copy back in the back there. And I write a column called Debriefing. And there's just never enough time at the reunions to get guys together and interview them and have them talk. We try. So debriefing is basically having one of our fellows recall a mission that is still there and to write down what happened. And the last thing that Robert Brown did for me is he gave me a blow-by-blow kind of day-by-day chronology of his walk as a POW from the Stalag Luft III down to where they ended up down in around Munich. So that'll be published in our next Ball of Fire in a couple of months. And speaking of the Ball of Fire, whoops. This is kind of the commercial part. The 93rd Bomb Group is known as Ted's Traveling Circus. And the reason it's known as Ted's Traveling Circus, I think Gregg alluded to, they were one of the early B-24 groups to England, and they almost immediately got sent to North Africa to support the British in their efforts. Then they were sent back to England, then they were sent back to North Africa again to prepare for the Ploesti mission of August 1st, 1943. Because of that, they became known as Ted's Traveling Circus, the Ted part being General Ted Timberlake. This is a day-by-day book chronology of the 93rd. The author of this was the aide-de-camp to General Timberlake, and it's a very, very good book. If you go on the internet, it costs you $100. If you pick up a sheet in the back there and join the 93rd, it'll cost you $25, and then the book will only cost you $70. So you saved yourself $5. It's just an excellent book that not only talks about, I mean, illustrates about the 93rd specifically, but I think if your family member was in a different group, certainly there are similarities in terms of base activity and missions and so forth. Speaking of bases, oh, yes.
We're getting ready to cut you off.
Okay, the hook. The 93rd Bomb Group is making a movie of the base Hardwick over in England from which they flew. Our goal is to get it on PBS, if we can. It'll be aired this coming September in New Orleans at the combination 8th Air Force. So, and the other thing that's going on with the 93rd, a B-24 made 25 missions first. 3.5 months before the Memphis Belle. As we speak, a memorial has been completed and is on its way to Iceland, where that particular B-24 called Hot Stuff crashed in Iceland, carrying General Frank Andrews, who most people feel was on his way back to get his fourth star and to be named the Supreme Commander over the European theater. But he crashed in Iceland. So in recognition of that particular event, the memorial, which is a 16-foot wide stainless steel B-24, will be installed in Iceland in 2018. Get the whole story by just Googling Hot Stuff. Thank you very much.
We're going to go into Q&A. You sit right here. Yeah.
You're going to have to use this.
Yeah.
Okay, we're going to go through some Q&A here. Does anybody have any questions for any of the people? Any questions? Any questions? Yes, sir, here.
To the nose gunner, please. Well, what did Germany look like?
Well, I'll tell you, when you flew over there, ground was clear, and it was pretty close to what you might see flying over a lot of our country here, even with the trees and what have you. That there was a lot more there to see than what I expected. And of course, the Rhine River going down through there, that was always was a lot of boats on that and what to see on the way back or whatever. But I did one time, just for the heck of it, there was a boat on the canal there, and there were some bombs left in the bomb bay, and I had control in the nose turret to drop bombs as well as the bombardier did. So I waited until we were getting kind of where I thought on that Rhine River, and I pushed the button and that bombs went out that were left there. There was only two or three. Anyway, it dropped right on that edge of that canal, right where that boat was sticking there. And afterwards, I was kind of sorry I did it because, you know, it could have blew up some people in the boat. The whole works, you know.
Were all of your missions over Germany and?
Yes, they were.
You did not get down to the Mediterranean. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Okay.
We didn't do any bombing in France anywhere.
Well, listen.
Nor Belgium either.
I hope all of you have taken something away. And Gregg, Barbara, Ruth, Jim, and
Bert.
I want you to fill out one of our mailing slip things. Son, help him with that. Thank you. See you next month on the Battle of the Bulge.
Support for this program provided by viewers like you. Thank you. Additional support provided through the Catherine B. Anderson Fund of the St. Paul Foundation. Upcoming roundtable topics can be found at www.mn-ww2roundtable.org. Production services provided by Barrows Productions.